Hi, my name is Meadow Caulfield and I'm an instructor here at Itasca Community College in the Natural Resources Department. Welcome to our Focus on Natural Resources Career Day. Today's area of emphasis will be natural resources law enforcement. Join me as I follow a natural resources law enforcement officer through his day-to-day on a day in northern Minnesota. I'll be able to ask him some questions about his career path and why he chose it, and also just some interesting things that you might want to know if you are considering this as a career path.
Hi, I'm Bill Marshall. I'm the Director of Enrollment Services at Itasca Community College. Itasca Community College is located in Grand Rapids, Minnesota, in southern Itasca County. At Itasca Community College, our normal application fee is $20, but we do have a promo code we're offering, ICCVikes, and that will save you that $20 up front. And then the application itself only takes about 15 minutes. It's really easy, there's no essay, and you'll be accepted within a day or two. If you'd like to visit campus, we do offer both on-campus in-person visits as well as virtual visits. So a lot of students find that the in-person visits are preferable because they get to interact with more staff and faculty, see what the real feel is on campus. Other than the application to Itasca, you're also going to want to submit your FAFSA, your free application for federal student aid. That's the same as if you would be applying to any other college. But that's going to open up different opportunities for grants, scholarships, on-campus work opportunities. Then you're also going to want to apply for our Itasca Community College Foundation scholarships. We give out over $140,000 in those scholarships every year, as well as a few other scholarship opportunities we will let you know about once you apply. One of the great benefits of Itasca is we do have on-campus housing. It's an option for you. You can be 2 or 3 minutes away from your class. If you want to apply for that, you want to do that early. So as a senior in high school and you're applying to Itasca, you can apply for the housing as early as December 1st of your senior year. And I would recommend doing the application December or January. Early February is fine as well, but the earlier the better. Once you're accepted to Itasca, we will reach out to you about registering for classes. We'll reach out to you at about February of your senior year, and you'll be registering as early April through May and June. It's better to come on the early side if you know you're attending, though, because all the classes will be wide open and you'll be able to get the perfect schedule. Classes start with fall semester, which begins the last week of August on a Monday. You'll start with orientation on that Monday. So instead of having your classes that day, you'll have a full day of orientation. And then you'll start with your Tuesday classes. We run through December for winter break. And then for spring semester, we start up again in January, but then you're done with class by mid-May.
My name is Shane Zavodnik. I'm a conservation officer for the state of Minnesota. My station is Cook, but I've worked and I do work a lot of the surrounding stations such as Tower, Hibbing, and the Virginia station as well. I grew up in Virginia, Minnesota here, graduated in 2004, and now I live just right outside of the Virginia area. So my main lake is Lake Vermilion, especially during the summer seasons. It gets very busy with tourists, whether it's angling, musky fishing, walleye fishing, sport boats, jet skiing, recreational. It's kind of got everything there. It's got the casino right on the lake too, so it draws in a variety of different people for different purposes, but it's my primary focus lake. And then it's got a few other smaller lakes just to the northwest. I also patrol, you know, Lake Vermilion is basically cut in half between the Cook Station and the Tower Station just to the east. So I do cover a lot of the Tower area. It's a lot busier typically during the summer months, but especially as of late with the COVID pandemic, the lake has been very busy throughout the entire area. So. It indeed keeps me busy from whether people are ice fishing or they're using it. There's a lot of snowmobiles, trails that intersect the lake too. So I get a lot of the snowmobile traffic, I get a lot of the angling traffic, and then obviously during the summer months as well. Yeah, so I've always been enthusiastic as far as the outdoors. I really like to hunt, fish, boat, snowmobile, ATV. I've got a cabin up in Ely too, so I feel like I'm very well accustomed, and basically how I got hired is I was ice fishing on a lake just north of Duluth, and a conservation officer asked me if I wanted to be a CO, and I kind of laughed at first, but he had heard that there was going to be some hiring in the near future, and guess here I am. I was always leaning towards the environmental aspect. I graduated with a degree in biochemistry and biology, and so I did a lot of environmental testing. I worked for the EPA in Duluth for 3 years, and then I worked for a private company doing different testing for mine companies, such as their water and their soils. So it was always environmental aspects towards my career path, and I knew I wanted to get into something a little bit different, and you know, I got really lucky as far as getting hired. I was there at the right time at the right place. So essentially, I wanted to get closer to home, which is in the Virginia, Minnesota area. So the closest station that I had chosen initially was the International Falls Station, and now the Cook Station that I'm in. And so basically, you can select any station prior to graduating from the academy that are open or that there will soon be open with retirements coming up. So essentially, there's going to be a lot of people retiring in the next 5 to 6 years. So a lot more stations are going to be opened up, and based on, you know, who's going where, what stations are opened up, it's just kind of being lucky on or where you want to go and where your family's at. So basically how the stations are selected is that you can select one, you know, maybe it is the station you've always wanted, but there typically is a station that's going to open within the next 5 to 6 years, or there's a station that's not too far. So, you know, essentially public land is everyone's land. It kind of brings me back to the deer hunting area where, you know, people put their stands on public land and they think that's their deer hunting area. Well, you know, that's not the case. It's anyone has the right to use that land. And so essentially rules and laws and regulations are put into place primarily first and foremost for public safety, whether it's speed limits on snowmobile trails, direction of travel during night with ATVs alongside roadways, whether it's ATV or safety or snowmobile safety certificates. Public safety is priority. After that, it's obviously managing our resources and make sure that they don't get exploited. And that's why we have limits on fish. And that's why recently the panfish limit has been looked at a lot more seriously, just because of today's technology and the growth of the sport. So, you know, basically what I like to amount is our rules and regulations is to manage the people. We don't manage the wildlife, if you will. If every human was taken off this earth today, the fish and the animals would do just fine. So we need a way to manage the people so the resources can be harvested at a reasonable rate where for generations to come, other people can enjoy the same sport that we're enjoying as well. So yeah, a year in the life really of a conservation officer is we basically go and we dictate our days based off of the type of activity that's given to us. So let's say it's early ice. We're checking fishermen that are going out there, you know, especially like on the Red Lakes and stuff like that where early ice comes quicker. A lot of us will do special details up there just because of the amount of people that go to Red Lake. We have the great opportunity of, you know, whether you want to work waterfall, which isn't too prevalent up here, you can go down to Rochester in December and check goose hunters. So we have a lot of flexibility on what we want to do. Pretty soon now, with the warmer weather hitting, rainy river is opening up. So with the catch and release of walleye or whether it's sturgeon fishing, I'll be focusing my efforts up there at least once or twice this year. And then, you know, obviously as opening fishing rolls around, we're checking walleye fishermen, pan fishermen, you know, different anglers throughout the state, and specifically me, Lake Vermilion. Once fall hits, we're checking for deer baits, we're checking trappers, we're checking small game hunters, whether it's pheasants in the west or we're checking turkey hunters. grouse hunters, and then obviously there's deer hunting. So basically, as the year progresses and changes, as the seasons change, we change as well. Right, so yeah, we have a hierarchy of conservation officers. We have a chief, we have our captains, our lieutenants, and then the field staff, which is what I do. But we also have specialized people, whether it's an ATV specialist or a rec vehicle specialist or a REO specialist. We also have RTOs that help specialize in different ATV instructor courses for people that want to instruct in different areas. So those RTOs help instructors for firearm safety to become firearm safety instructor certified. And then you get different COs that just specialize in different areas that they're accustomed to. You know, maybe it's people down in the South Rochester area that are specialized and know a lot about like ginseng, whereas up here, you know, I don't know anything about ginseng. So, you know, COs basically spread throughout the state are specialized in a lot of different things that we're not really accustomed to. Whereas people up in Lake of the Woods, the Northwest area, they obviously have their elk hunting, but then they have Lake of the Woods. So they have to know their borders, regulations, and then they also have to know special regulations in like the Lake of the Woods area as well. All right, so this is one of our squad snowmobiles that we have. I got the same model. We just got these brand new. Typically, we cycle them out 4 to 5 years, depending on mileage, overall condition. So this particular snowmobile is set up as far as it's a good trail runner, and it also is great off trail. A lot of the work, such as trapping, or you know, if we need to get to an emergency, or if we're just going out to discover new land, it's really good, especially this backcountry Renegade. It's got the wider skis. They're pushed in a bit. And then we have the wider track and the longer track that really helps get off the trail and travel on the less beaten path, if you will. So all of our snowmobiles are equipped with emergency lights. Whether we're making a stop for a registration violation or someone speeding, this gives people the heads up to slow down and stop for us. Basically, you know, a typical snowmobile year is that we got those first-time runners. They have that need for speed. We're doing a lot of radar work on some of the more troubled areas. Typically, the longer, straighter paths that the snowmobile groomers groom. And so, essentially, from then on, we are monitoring. And using our snowmobiles to check anglers, especially if the snow is deep, to get across lakes, to get on trails, to obviously check trappers and whatnot. This is our main means of travel throughout the winter year, or throughout the winter. All right, so yeah, it depends on station, but station dependent, we have different size boats based on the bodies of water that we have. Obviously, if it's a smaller body of water, if it's kind of a carrying type of access, the sport boat's a really good boat. You know, it can be handled with 1 to 2 people quite easily. The trailer, you can swivel it around if you are in a pinch and you can't turn around. So this is a good emergency boat, especially for like duck hunters and such. They're in a really swampy area. You can't get to them. So this is a good dragon boat. And then it's just got a little 6-horse kicker on it. The next boat here, we have a tiller boat, obviously made for a little bit bigger body of water. More conducive to if you want to work with other people in it, it'll hold 1 to 2 or 3 other people. So there's a lot more space in it. Obviously the engines are a little bit bigger, depending on where you're at. It's got a depth finder too. So this is kind of your little runabout type boat that's good for quick checks. Obviously, if you're not going to be on the water an entire day, it's easy to get on and easy to get off the water quite quickly. And then here's this is the Lake Chameleon boat here. This is approximately 20 feet. It's the Pro V, so essentially, it's a lot deeper boat, obviously, and the metal and the aluminum is a lot stiffer on here. It's a lot heavier duty gauge. So when you're ripping across Lake Vermilion, especially, you know, you get those 2-3 footers and the wind's really whipping or the weather's nasty, you know, the bigger boats are a lot better. This boat is equipped with special seats, especially when you're hitting the larger waves. So it's called a smooth moose boat or a pedestal, and it's essentially like an air ride type seating system. So when you hit a bump, you don't feel the direct impact. It's got a lot of cushion on it. A lot of the boats are equipped with emergency lights too. So if you need to make a stop, you turn on your emergency lights. Some of them have horns, some of them have sirens as well. And this one is equipped with like a 225 E-Tech, and then it's got a kicker on the side and then a trolling motor as well. Basically, the kicker and the trolling motor are for emergency purposes only, just in case the main motor breaks down. But just like any other boat, you know, we have our throwables, we have our life jackets, we have decibel meters for loud boats, your bigger sport boats that are cause a nuisance sometimes, that are really loud on the lake. You can also run radar in these. Some lakes have no wake zones or specific speed zones, so there's a lot of work that's done, obviously, during the summer. This is our bread and butter, basically. Especially with Canada being shut down now, the lakes up here have been really, really busy. The Lake Vermilion, the Rainy Lakes, the Lake Captogama area. Yeah, so this is a typical ATV that we get for our duty ATV. Basically, when we run this from fall to early ice. Basically, if we can't get around on our snowmobiles, we're gonna be using our ATVs to get around, just because it's not good for the track and there's no traction at all. So, especially now ATVing, the sport of ATVing and the ATV trails are getting a lot more popular. So we seem like we're using these a lot more. And then obviously when the small game season hits, the deer hunting season hits, we're using this a lot. So. Just like our snowmobiles and our boats, they are equipped with the emergency lights, just because we are law enforcement. If we do need to stop someone, we always put these on, so easily accessible. This one's a Sportsman 570. Typically, this is what all the COs are getting now. Some of them have GPS-equipped options on them. So yeah, for the most part, I would say if there's no snow, we're running our ATVs. Yeah, so this is my squad here. It's basically what I live in when I'm working. This is where I get a lot of the paperwork done. This is where a lot of the enforcement action gets done, and it's equipped like basically any other squad. We do have a lot of different nuances to fit our needs, but conservation officers need a pickup truck to get from point A to point B in a lot of different situations. So, you know, we do put on quite a bit of highway miles, but when we need to get off trail or we need to get on trails, that's where our squads differ from others. So basically, this is a diesel, it's a 2500 Chevy. It's kind of the last in this fleet. Yeah, so we have, like I said, our squads are equipped differently than other squads, law enforcement, but this is a dual purpose ramp system. And it's nice because the ramps fit underneath in the bed. We don't have to store them on the side. We don't have to store them up top or anything. So right now this is set up for a snowmobile because the slides are on the outside, but we can swap them and then it's made for ATVs. So we're using these ramp systems a lot. Obviously, during the winter months, we're using them for snowmobiles because that's how we transport our snowmobiles in our squad. And then the same with our ATVs, we're transporting our ATVs in our squad too. So we got a special system here with the tie downs, and then special carbides to run up the ramps onto our squads with. And then we obviously have the toolbox on the side to hold our ratchet straps down, axes maybe, different tools we need. And so this is the inside of my squad. I've got ice picks ready here just in case I get a water emergency. Obviously we have, this is kind of where everyone stores their binoculars up here. I got a GPS system here, my squad computer there, and then all the controls there. And then maybe you can see better here. This is where we have our rifle in the center here, and then I have my shotgun here up, stowed away up top here. And then I got kind of a do it all kind of a backpack here. I got different emergency stuff, band-aids, tourniquets, different patches of sorts, just in case someone runs into an accident and I'm the first one to respond. I got a shovel here, winter kit, and I carry a life jacket just in case, especially now the ice is getting a lot iffier, and if someone goes in, you don't know. So we always typically carry some type of PFD with us, even when the ice is good, or especially later on in the year when the ice gets kind of iffy.
All right, Shane, thank you so much for giving us a tour of all your equipment and kind of explaining some of the things about being a conservation officer in northern Minnesota. I guess I wanted to ask you a couple questions on behalf of the students, and one of those is, who would be a good fit for a conservation officer?
So I think anyone really with a strong natural resources background and just has a passion for the outdoors in general, it would be a good fit. You know, one thing I think is something that's needed, especially being in law enforcement and being a conservation officer, is that if you don't like confrontation, it's going to be a very hard position for you to succeed in, and that goes with any type of law enforcement type of career. So there's people with guns that aren't happy, there's people with knives that aren't happy. You know, those are the type of people that we deal with every day. Not the unhappy people, but basically, you know, any fisherman has a knife on them or with them in a boat. Any hunter obviously has a gun with them. So you do have to know how to talk to people, and it is a customer service type of mentality where you talk to people. You know, you got to be able to read people. If they're amped up, you got to be able to try to bring them down to your level. So again, like I said, if you have a passion for being in law enforcement and you have a passion for the outdoors, I would strongly encourage people like that to look into it.
I think it's pretty important to bring up that idea of confrontation. I think a lot of people don't realize how much confrontation is involved in law enforcement,
right.
And a lot of your guys' interactions might focus on that. So it's certainly a very important consideration that I think a lot of students need to think about if they're interested in it. So what's kind of the pathway for students as far as an educational or a vocational background for becoming a conservation officer? We discussed earlier off camera kind of your background, but and you know, you kind of gave a description here a little bit ago about your degrees.
Right.
So I mean, what is the pathway? Is there a set pathway, or is there multiple ways to become a conservation officer?
Well, there's a lot of different ways in this day and age to become a conservation officer. And for me, like I had told you, I graduated with a degree in biochemistry and biology. So I was by no means the traditional law enforcement type background. Basically, what the state has been doing for the last couple of years now is looking at hiring diversified personnel and coupling that with people either in law enforcement or that's already a degree or has their degree in law enforcement. So it's basically they look at two different pools. They look at your traditional pool and they look at your non-traditional pool. And so me being in the non-traditional pool, I applied for the position. Basically, what happened is that I sent out an application, My application was accepted, and then I went through a test. And then if you pass the test, you get an interview, and that's before a board of three or four people. One of them is a CO, and then another one is from Human Resources, and I can't remember where the other ones were from. But if you do pass the oral board, then they'll ask for your background packet. So basically that packet entails what you did your entire life, who you contacted your entire life, your family, your friends, your dogs, your neighbors, everything.
Everywhere you've lived.
Everywhere you lived, everything. All of the people that you've interacted as an employee. So that backgrounder gets a scope of what you did as growing up to who you are now and to what type of person you're at, are. And maybe come in the future. So with that being said, after you pass the background, then you go through a psychological evaluation test, a brief fitness test, and then, you know, obviously if you're on the non-traditional, they have to get you peace officer certified in the state of Minnesota. Basically that was it's a 5-month peace officer certificate course. They basically take a 1 to 2 year course and shove that into a 5-month course, so it's pretty intense.
Okay.
And then after that, if you do pass it and you get your peace officer certificate, you go to a 4 to 5 month academy training at Camp Ripley, and that's where the traditional, the people with the law enforcement degree or the prior law enforcement, meet up with you at Camp Ripley.
Okay.
And then you go through that 4 or 5 months, going through various scenarios, real life type scenarios as a conservation officer. And then for 4 more months, you go through a field training program.
Okay, and what's the field training program? My understanding is you guys travel and work with established COs?
Right, so we're all given to a primary field training officer. That primary conservation officer is basically he meets you and or he or she works with you the first month to see where you're at, and you're really given not a huge expectation of really doing the majority of the work. You're there for observation, you're there to see what they do on a daily basis, and then after that you go to another field training officer for about a month.
Okay.
Thereafter, you go through third phase, you go to a different area throughout the state, and then your fourth phase, you go back to your primary officer, your
okay.
field training officer. So that officer, that field training officer, the primary, gets to kind of see where you started, and then actually, you know, when you're with them, he gives the final year, or he or she gives the final year and A on whether you're not going to pass the academy or the off-field training opportunity.
Okay, and then from there, if you pass, then?
Yeah, then you, during the academy, you get to bid on stations.
Okay.
If you pass the field training, you're stationed in the station that you select.
Okay, wonderful. So that's probably the better description I've ever heard of it in one sitting, so that's good. I appreciate that. What, I guess when you're a student, you're in high school and you're thinking about, you know, becoming a conservation officer or law enforcement, natural resources, you know, there's U.S. Forest Service and U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service and other agencies, tribal, to take in consideration as well. What are some tips or something that you might give a student, you know, stay out of trouble, should be involved in the outdoors, you know, kind of maybe something to think about?
Yeah, obviously, being certified in everything you can, whether it's ATV, snowmobile, obviously firearm, trapping, obviously staying out of trouble is a big thing, but reaching out to area conservation officers, whether you're, obviously with the COVID thing happening right now, we can't do ride-alongs, but I certainly have gotten quite a few calls from various people looking to be a conservation officer. And when we start doing them, I would strongly urge those people to not only work or ride along with one seal, but Various seals, okay. And maybe even throughout the state if you have the ability to, just to see the different lays of the land and get a better diversification. So there's also like an internship conservation officer where you get to shadow. I know there was one in Rapids.
Okay.
So when that hiring freeze stops throughout the state, then you can do that internship or back. It's just a really glorified background, basically, of shadowing a conservation officer for a certain amount of hours. So that would look certainly good on an application.
We know that, you know, kind of these different trajectories to becoming a conservation officer, and there's a lot of different paths.
Right.
And a lot of people are interested in that career, but there needs to be some considerations, and important ones in your life when you become a CO or a law enforcement officer. And maybe you'd want to touch on some of those considerations, things you should think about before going to become law enforcement.
Yeah, so in this particular program, if you're not in law enforcement, I mean, it's you're devoting your time for sure for a year. You know, the hiring process from the start to the finish, from when you get interviewed to your test taking all the way to completion of field training, that's almost 2 years.
Okay.
I'm not saying you're away from your family that long, but certainly that 1 year time span, you are away from your family quite a bit if you do have kids or significant others. You know, as we had talked, you know, you can't be shy around confrontation. It's just one of those things in your career as being in law enforcement that you have to take in consideration. And it's really hard to turn off being in law enforcement when you're out doing other things you enjoy. So, you know, I hate to say it, but when you're a peace officer, whether it's a conservation officer, whether it's a city cop or county, once you're a cop, you're pretty much always in law enforcement 24/7. So.
Okay, so it's kind of a lifestyle, it's a big change.
Yep, and really to engage and be a part of the community, you take a lot of calls when you're not on duty. Mm-hmm. And especially during the busy year of deer hunting, mm-hmm. you're getting calls at maybe 2-3 in the morning because someone shot a deer out of someone's property. So you get a wide variety of different calls at all sorts of hours of the day, and certainly you don't have to be on duty or you don't have to always answer those calls, but there are times, especially during the deer hunting season, where I expect calls at any given time of the day or night.
So it's basically, you can't leave your work at work. Your work is home with you.
It does, and that's one thing too, is our offices and our squads and at home a lot of the times. We do have our district offices and our regional offices, but a lot of the times we are working at home, mm-hmm. Doing whether it's paperwork we need to get done, whether it's vehicle maintenance and stuff like that. It's either in our trucks or probably done at home.
Okay. Well. Well, you know, that's a big commitment. So what are the positives? I guess, what's your favorite part of your job?
I mean, my favorite part of the job, a lot of CEOs says the hardest decision each day is whether or not you take a right or a left out of your driveway. And so we have free rein to really do anything throughout the state. Right now, with it being March, the Rainy River is going to open up, so COs from all over the state that want to maybe work on the Rainy River and do sturgeon fishing if they never have, get to go do that. There's still walleye fishing open throughout the state. We can go work walleye fishermen down in the cities area, in the pools in pool 2, pool 3, pool 4. So it's just an excellent career. We do have a boss, but basically you get to be the boss of where you want to go and what you want to do for the day.
All right. The freedom.
The freedom.
Yes. That is definitely a huge appeal. Well, those are awesome answers, and I really appreciate you taking the time to meet with me today and share your career with these students. And if they're interested or want to know more, I guess, who would you suggest outside of local COs to contact? Is there a place that you would send them?
like I said, you could probably just go on the Minnesota DNR website and look up conservation officers. There's different links and different contacts as far as people who would to contact as far as being a conservation officer. Like you said, you know, obviously just reaching out to your area COs. We're all looking for the next applicant, the next person that's wants to be in this career, and it is a great career for sure. And it's a lifetime career, and you know, it's exciting almost each and every day. So like I said, reaching out to different COs throughout your community. If there's park rangers in your area, reach out to them. You know, talk to your different wildlife personnel or fisheries personnel, because that will help broaden your knowledge on a lot of stuff that we do.
Okay. All right. Well, that's great advice. Thanks again, Shane. I really appreciate it.
Not a problem. Thank you.
Yep.